Just a moment, I'm going to be in Acts chapter 2. We want to celebrate Pentecost this week in different ways, and it is going to be, I believe, extremely beneficial. This world needs a Pentecostal church. I mean an Acts chapter 2 church. Okay? I mean a church that has authority and power and believes in exercising dominion. Okay, I believe that. Amen. In fact, you can't even preach on the Holy Ghost without giving them the Acts. So I'm going to give you the Acts. If you would stand for these four verses. If you are a classical Pentecostal like I am, you know these verses, Acts chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house. That's a good place to start. Let him in your house. Ain't no wonder, people don't get filled with the Holy Ghost. You don't want him in the house. He filled all the house where they were sitting, and there appeared unto them cloven hoof, forked tongues, like as a fire, and set upon each of them. That's my prayer. Set upon each of us. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost and began. Somebody say began. Began. You can't show me where they ever stopped. Began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance. Before you're seated, I want you to turn around and tell your neighbor, you better watch me today. Because I am going to be a representation of the power of Pentecost. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord, and please indulge me as I try to preach on the subject from Passover to Pentecost. Passover to Pentecost. One of the most recognizable, identifiable, inspirational names in all of the Bible, in fact, in all of history, is that of Moses. Moses was called, sanctioned by God, to be a deliverer, to transition people. From Egypt. Egypt is the place of limitation, place of restriction. Take them through the wilderness and take them to Canaan. Canaan is a land of abundance. In essence, he's taking them from the land of not enough through the land of just enough to the land of more than enough. Egypt was a place where there was not enough straw, not enough mortar, not enough bricks, not enough cots, not enough food, not enough sleep, not enough. And he takes them into the wilderness where there was just enough. And the manna fell according to the need. In fact, you had to believe God every day when you got up that the manna was going to fall in proportion to what you needed, which simply says that if it was a husband and wife, God sent enough manna for two people. But if it were four in the house, then he would send enough. My God shall supply all of your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now, you couldn't have a panic attack now and go out and say, well, I need to get tomorrow's blessing today. You had to trust God that if I was God on Monday, I'll be God on Tuesday. And if I took care of you today, I'll be back to take care of you again tomorrow. So God was the El Shaddai. He was the all-sufficient one through the wilderness wanderings. And then finally they come to the land of abundance. The Bible said in Deuteronomy that it is a land flowing with milk and honey. They find iron in the stones and brass in the hill. They eat bread without scarceness. The Bible said water is flowing out of the deep places. They have everything that they need. And listen, let me just deviate for a moment and warn you. I know we want to go to heaven. Thank God we are going to heaven. How many of you are going to heaven? We ought to see a lot of people saved this morning then. Amen. So we are on our way to heaven. There's only two options, heaven or hell. Amen. Say, well, I don't believe in hell. Then you can't believe in heaven. Okay, you don't get to pick and choose. So I believe that there is a place called hell where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. It is so horrific until Jesus said, whatever you have to do to stay out of it, do it. He said, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. If your hand offends you, cut it off. He said, you're better to go through life maimed than to have two eyes or two good hands, right? Cast into hell. So I believe that there is a place called hell. And I know that this modern culture and mindset says that God is a God of love and he wouldn't send anybody to hell. And I want to tell you, God's not sending you to hell. You're sending yourself to hell. Amen. 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 He doesn't want anybody to perish, not willing that any perish, but that all come to repentance. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. That is his plan. If you go to hell, you go to hell over the plan of salvation, which is sufficient to save from the guttermost to the uttermost those that come to God by Christ Jesus. Can somebody say thank you, Lord? Hallelujah, hallelujah. So I want to tell you that I set before you life and death. Choose life. Lean over and tell your neighbor, choose life. Choose life, choose life. Amen, amen. But while we are on our way to heaven, and I plan to make it by the grace of God, I am going to heaven. And after this week, I plan to take a few more folk with me. Amen. So I believe in heaven, but I don't want to just live for heaven. Hello? Which means I don't want to be sufficient to have just enough to get by. And if you think I'm talking materialistically and financially and in the natural realm, I am not. I am talking about I want to have more than enough. I don't want to just have enough to take care of me. I want to have enough. I'm talking Holy Ghost. I want to have enough Holy Ghost to say, silver and gold have I none. Which means that I've heard preachers say that he didn't have silver and gold. No. It's deeper than that. He said, if I give you silver or give you gold, that's not going to take care of what you need. Because you're going to still come back tomorrow a lame man sitting at the gate looking for more silver and more gold. But I have got something. He had just come out of an upper room experience. And he said, I can take you by the hand right now and there can be a transference. And in the name of Jesus, you can rise up and walk. Somebody say amen. I want to see the hand of everybody that believes that God has given us the authority in which we can live victoriously in this life. The devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I come to give you life more abundantly. And I'm not talking about just for a couple of hours on Sunday. I'm talking about Romans 5:17 that says we reign in life. Huh. Now, I'm not trying to tell you that there's not going to be some seasons in which your faith is not severely tested and tried, and you're going to have to look up to see bottom. We all understand those times and those seasons, right? The Bible said even those that are in Christ Jesus shall suffer some persecution, right? Jesus said in this world you're going to have some tribulation, but he put a comma, not a period, which means slow down but keep reading. He said, I have overcome the world, and the overcomer lives on the inside of us. The Bible said, thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. If I ain't winning, it can't be over, because guess what? No weapon formed against me will prosper, and every tongue that rises up against me in judgment, God will condemn it. Have you not read? We are the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. We are blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when we go out, blessed when we come in. Somebody shout, I'm already blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed. So the thing is, we don't want you to adopt a mentality of maintenance, that I just stand here where I am. We want you to progress. So let me walk you through this. God created man in his image and in his likeness. We have maintained the image because we're still Trinity. I'll talk about it tonight. We're still Trinity as he is Trinity. So we maintain the image, but we've lost the likeness. To be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. That's all I ask, to be like him. So man was made to be the reflection of God, his representative on earth. Am I safe? So man was inspired, breathed into the gift of life. But when man sinned, he now has expired. Because sin separates us from God. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The wages of sin is death. And the penalty for sin is expulsion. Just like Satan was evicted from heaven, Adam was evicted from the garden, from the presence of God, cut off from his life source. He was the theonospre, the breath of God was in him, the pneuma and the ruach, and he was operating through the power of God. But now he is a man of the senses. He is homo sapien. He was homo pneumaticus, but now he is homo sapien. Now he is the man of the senses, and everything that he wants, he thinks the senses can provide. And he's lost the inspiration of Almighty God. Are you with me? So God gets ready to reconnect to his man. And he does it by reaching out to Abram. The Bible says that Abram is connected by God in a place called Shechem. And God speaks to him. And he said, I'm going to bless you. Make your name great. You'll be a blessing. I'll bless them that bless you. Curse them that curse you. And through you shall all nations of the earth be blessed. The problem was he didn't have a seed. The Bible said his body was as good as dead. And Sarah was past the age of childbearing. But I want to tell you that nothing is too dead for the word of God to resurrect it. I know we're clamoring for people to lay hands on us, but what you need to do is find you a word, because that word will not return void. It will accomplish that which he pleases and prosper wherever he sent it. There is power in his word, whether it be the widow of Nain's son, whether it be Jairus' daughter, or whether it be a four-day-old Lazarus that's been dead for 4 days. God is able to speak a word and life return. If you want to see the power of Jesus' word, just look at him hanging on the cross. Death can hover, death can circle and surround him, but death cannot touch him, because as long as he's talking, death has to stay away, because the power of life and death was in his tongue. Only when he said, it is finished, I finished the sermon and I'm going to commit my spirit unto the Father, could death reach him. Tell somebody there's power in the word of God. So the word of God hit Abram. And he's got jet fuel. I'm waiting on somebody. It hit Sarah. And she goes to the OBGYN at the age of 90 and says, I want to have a pregnancy test. And she goes to Babies R Us and buys strollers and cribs with a Social Security check. Come on, some of y'all need to smile now. That's worth laughing at. So God is moving them, transitioning them. They have to say goodbye to everything that's familiar. They have to say goodbye to their environment, their surroundings, and they got to go out. And Abraham goes out not knowing where he went. He just knows where he's going is better than where he's been. I'm talking Pentecost. You may not know what you're getting into, but I want to tell you what you're going to get into is much better than what you think you've had. Because God has a fresh wind that he is releasing on the hungry, thirsty souls in this hour. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So they end up traveling about 240 miles and they end up in Canaan. The short version is there is a famine in Canaan and they go down to Egypt and eventually they get out of Egypt. But guess what? There's going to be another famine, and his family returns to Egypt. This time, Joseph is the forerunner. Joseph preserves life. And now all of Israel is sustained, that family sustained, and they eat at Pharaoh's table. But the Bible says that there arose another Pharaoh that did not recognize Joseph. So for the next 400 years, they are put into slavery and Egyptian bondage. Now for 400 years, it's a cruel taskmaster. And if their tally of bricks is not supplied and satisfied every day, there was going to be a penalty that would ensue. But every night when they went to bed, they began to pray for freedom, remembering that God is a God of vengeance. God knows when and how to repay. You're going to find that out in the life of Joseph and Israel, because everything that Joseph went through, God was going to bless him at the end. Everything that the seed of God went through, God was going to bless them. In fact, in Exodus chapter 1 and verse 12, the Bible said the more they afflicted them, the more they grew. I'm going to preach and make you clap right here. I want to tell you, you are being set up. Some of you need to go to Walmart, or you need to go to CVS and get you some thank you notes and go ahead and make them out and get ready to send them to every one of your enemies that tried to cut you off at the knees, that lied on you, come on, that tried to execute your reputation. And you need to tell them thank you, because what you meant for evil, God has turned it around for good. Somebody shout yes. David said it was good for me that I had been afflicted. I want you to tell your neighbor, payback's coming. Payback's coming. I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know what shape or what form, but God didn't let you go through this for nothing. The Bible said the suffering of this present time will not compare to the glory that shall be revealed. If you want to know how much glory's coming, look at how much hell you had to fight. Yeah. So here's what God does. God said, I'm setting you up to bless you. He finds a man from the burning bush by the name of Moses. He said, I want you to go tell Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, let my people go. And the Bible says that Israel is God's child, his firstborn. So God says to Pharaoh, he said, you've been messing with my kids, so now I'm going to mess with your kids. Don't touch God's people. Keep your mouth off of us. Keep your hands to yourself. So God began to send plague after plague after plague. And people want to argue over speaking in tongues. I see where God spoke lice. God spoke frog. God has more ways to get you out than you've ever thought about. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all you could ask or think, according to the power that works in you. Can I get a yes in the room? So God says, I'm going to get you out. There's going to be one more plague. And after this, you're going to come out all together. It was the death of the firstborn. And the firstborn was going to die. The firstborn cattle, the firstborn in the flock, the firstborn of the servant, the firstborn in Pharaoh's house. The Bible said there was a great cry throughout the land, and there was not a house where there was not at least one dead. But he said, I've got a way for you to avoid it. Any preachers in the room? He said, I got a way for you to miss out on what's coming. He said, I want you to take the blood of a spotless lamb. This is a precursor to Christ. The lamb slain from the foundation of the world. The lamb without blemish or without spot. And I want you to apply it to the side post and the upper post. Baby, I just gave you the shape of the cross. He said, I want you to apply it to the side post and the upper post. Because when I see the blood, I will pass over you. It might stop at everybody else's house, but it will not be able to stop at your house. God said, apply it openly. You apply it on the side post and upper post, but not on the threshold. You know why? You don't trample on the blood. I want to tell you right now, if you're a sinner or a backslider, the worst thing you can do is sit in a Holy Ghost filled service like this after hearing a warning from God and walk out of here, because you're walking over and trampling over the blood of Jesus. But here's what the second application is. You've got to put the blood out for everybody to see it. It has to be an open application. The Bible talks about the seal or the sign or the emblem or the mark of the Antichrist. One of the places it could be put is in the palm of your right hand. But there's only one place you could put the seal of the Lamb, and that's on your forehead. You see, in this hour, you better understand that this ain't no day to be going undercover. This ain't no day to be playing hide and seek. This ain't no day to be a 007 saint. Come on, somebody, a secret service believer. This is the time for you to say, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. And I'm here, because of the blood. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Somebody thank him for the blood right now. Thank you for the blood. It was the Father, come on men, it was the Father that made sure the blood was applied on his house. Quit passing the buck, men. Come on. Bring your family to church. I didn't say send them, I said bring them. Come on. Bring your family to church. Make sure that they're in the house of God up under the blood of God. We're not trying to put people in every seat. We're not trying to pad the membership roll. We're trying to get people ready for what's coming. Listen, I'm not going to try to convince you I'm the most spiritual person in the room, but I got enough sense to know the hellhounds are barking. I got enough sense to know that tribulation clouds are forming and about ready to roll up in here. I'm trying to tell you, make your calling and election sure. Get your kids in the house. Get your family members in the house. Get your neighbors in the house. Bring them in a wheelchair. Bring them in on a stretcher. Whatever you do, get them in the house of God. If the blood could work for Noah, if the blood could work for Rahab, if the blood could work for a Philippian jailer, it'll work for your family too. Somebody shout yes. So God said, after this one, you're going to be free. And they came out. And the Bible said there was not one feeble person among their tribes. The Bible says that they left with the wealth of Egypt. They came out better than when they went in. So now they begin to leave. Pharaoh says, wait a minute, there goes my bankroll. Who's going to do the work around here? And he decides that he is going to chase them. And he chases them to the Red Sea. And it looks like God is a poor general, poor navigator. Because you got mountains on both sides, Pharaoh breathing down their neck. And that stretch of the Red Sea is 15 miles across. And guess what God says? Stand still. What? You got to be kidding me. Stand still? You know, that's hard for church people to stand still. We got to do something. Come on. Come on. And most of the time we create a bigger problem to be fixed by God. But God said, stand still. I know that you hear the thundering hoofbeats, but stand still. I know you can taste the dust flying off chariot wheels, but stand still. Because today, the enemy you have seen, you will see again, no more forever. So God gives a blast from his nostril, and the Red Sea stands up like a heap, and the people of God cross through. And Pharaoh says, arrogant, egocentric Pharaoh says, if they got through, I can get through. And God let him walk through. And right in the middle, he didn't see it, but right in the middle, there was an X. X marks the spot, because every enemy
has a date of expiration and a place of termination. You didn't hear what I said. You just got to keep walking. It's a setup. God didn't take you that way so that he could get rid of you. God took you that way so that he could get victory for you. Tell your neighbor, it's a setup. I didn't understand what God was doing, but now I'm getting ready to stand still and see the victory of the Lord. Oh, would you give the Lord a hand of praise right now? Hallelujah.
So now says, God, I want to teach you something. And he brings them to Mount Sinai, Exodus 19. Don't panic. I'm going to stop in Acts 2. I lost half the congregation. So God said, I want to make you a peculiar treasure. I want you to be a nation unto me. I want a physical representation. I'm trying to give you your glory back. You fail, but I'm trying to give you the glory back. So at Sinai, God gives them judgments, ordinances, and laws. Okay? The judgments were to help us handle contentions between people. The judgments helped us to know how to worship God. Okay, and he gave them feast days, and he told them how to carry out and conduct business. But then he gave them the law. The purpose of the law was not to save them, because the keeping of the law, by it no flesh can be saved. It was to show them how far they were and that they needed a Savior. Because God was trying to show them that I'm other than. Holy means other than. It means separate. It means distinct. It means incomparable. It means there's nobody like me. We usually say light and dark, left and right, God and Satan. No! They are not opposites and equals. They may be converse, but they are not equal. He's the God of this world, but look how that reads. It's a little g. He is just the little g God. Come on, that ain't D, but that's good. That's a t-shirt. He is the... He's just the little g God. We serve the big G God. But he said, I'm showing you I'm other than, right? I am not a man. I created man, but I'm not a man. See, it's hard to define all God is and all God can do. Even Moses struggled with that at the call, because he said, now, Lord, we don't even know your name. And if I go back and tell your children that I've had an encounter with you, they're going to say, surely he introduced himself. He said, so who am I going to tell them you are? And God said, you just tell them I am that I am. I'm too much to put in a title. I'm too much to... Come on, to put into a name and a description. He said, I am water, but I'm also fire. Ah, yes. He said, I am the shepherd, but I'm also the lamb. He said, I'm the Alpha and the Omega. I'm the first and the last. I'm the beginning and the end. Don't you try to limit God today based on what you saw out of him yesterday. He is more than enough. He will supply all my need. He is my El Shaddai. Somebody shout yes. Hallelujah. So God gets them to Sinai. Exodus 19. Let me give you a brief description. Thunder, lightning, fire, sound of trumpets, trembling, quaking, movement. Beware those people that claim the Holy Ghost but don't ever move. Because God's not just wind, he's rushing mighty wind. He's not just bread, he's living bread. He's not just water, he's living water. He's not just fire, he's consuming fire. So here it is. I want you to see this. So God says, you come up, I'm coming down. Sounds like the upper room to me. You come up, I'm coming down. And when it's all over, Moses comes back and has a word for the people. Do you see this? So the Pentecost version is, that Jesus lived, died, and rose again. 40 days he showed himself alive by many infallible proofs. And then he tells them, now you're going to be the proof that I'm alive. I'm going to try it over here. Now you're going to be the proof that I'm alive, because I want you to go to an upper room. I know you got ministry you want to start, but not till you've been to the upper room. I know you got churches you want to build, but not till you've been to the upper room. Come on. He said, because you need the tools, you need the equipment, you need the empowerment. He said, because you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. John baptized you with water, but you're about to be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. Somebody shout fire. I don't know where we got this fireless Pentecost from. I don't know where people claim to be filled with the Holy Ghost, but they don't ever speak in tongues. And they want to say, well, there's other gifts. I know there's the other fruit and there's other signs. But guess what? When they were filled with the Holy Ghost, they spake with tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance. So here's what he's after. John 1:17. The law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Law is knowledge. Grace is empowerment. We have a lot of people that they have the knowledge. Don't shout me down now. They have the knowledge, but they don't have the experience. They're trying to see, but they've never tasted. The Bible said you taste, then you see. Am I right about it? So the Bible says in Acts 1 and 3, these things Jesus began to do and teach. Moses taught, Jesus did. And we got a lot of people that can teach you what ought to be done, but they don't have the power to do it. The Holy Ghost is the power to achieve. He is the power to accomplish. I know you have those that say, well, the Holy Ghost and healings and miracles and gifts, that just vanished mysteriously with the disciples and the apostles. Oh, really? Did people stop getting sick and don't need a healer? Are there people no longer in need of deliverance? So why would he take away the ability, the unction to function? Right? Now, there are those that think that there's a missing chapter in the book of Acts, because the book of Acts doesn't have a formal close, or a complimentary close, or a benedictory prayer. You get that in the rest of the New Testament. You read it and you know that's it. You don't find that in the book of Acts. And some want to say there's a missing chapter. I want to tell you that the book of Acts was never supposed to close. It was never supposed to end. In fact, if I ask you to turn to Acts 29, you ought to look to the person beside of you, because they are to be an extension of what we see in the book of Acts. It is the Acts of the Apostles. The gospel show me what Jesus did. Acts shows me what the apostles did through the power of the Holy Ghost, not by might or by power, but by the Spirit of God. Somebody shout yes. They were an extension. They were an extension. Jesus went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed to the devil. They were an extension. Greater works than these shall you do, because I go to my Father which is in heaven. They were an extension, a continuation. I'm going to probably upset a few folk, but I usually do that. I don't feel like I've really preached if I hadn't done that somewhere in the sermon. Jesus did not birth an anesthetized, mummified, listless, lifeless, lethargic, petrified church. He left the church that was performing miracles, signs, and wonders. I want to tell you, as we celebrate Pentecost this week, you don't have a junior member of the Godhead. I know he's listed in sequence as the third or the last, but that doesn't mean he's any less relevant or important than the Father or the Son. He's just as much God as Jesus.
He's just as much God as the Father. In fact, Peter said regarding Ananias and Sapphira, he said, you have lied unto God and lied unto the Holy Ghost. If we ever capture the truth that the same Spirit that brought Jesus out of the tomb lives in us, I want to tell you, we will dismantle, we will dislodge principalities and powers and strongholds off of our cities, and we will break generational curses off of our family. Oh, somebody shout, I'm with you.
So notice, here we go. Notice at Sinai, there was a sight and sound spectacular. Sight, sound, and speech. Say it with me. Sight, sound, and speech. On the day of Pentecost, there was sight, sound, and speech. And they spoke with tongues. And I've often thought, well, why didn't you just make their eyes glow? You know, why don't you do something like that? And I finally found the answer in James, the tongue can no man tame. But there is a way to tame the tongue. The Holy Ghost, surely if he can get you to talk in the Spirit, he can get you to walk in it. Oh, Lordy. I thought I was in my church there for a second. Sorry. So Pentecost was a sight and sound. Somebody say sound. When God spoke originally, watch, it was not for conversation, because there was nobody for him to talk to. It was not for conversation, okay? It was not for instruction. It was not for even inspiration. Watch it. It was for creation. Because there is a sound that can cause things to show up. I said, there is a sound that can make things happen. So let me just give you, you know, what sound is for dummies kind of thing, because that's the only way I could get it. So sound is waves. Sound is waves, and it strikes the ear, okay? It strikes the anvil, the hammer, the stirrup, the cochlea. The cochlea is like piano strings or guitar strings, and when there's a movement on it, there's sound. Are you following me? When there's a movement, there is a sound, and sound causes things to happen. So it made me think about the Holy Ghost, that when the Holy Ghost moves, there ought to be a sound. Something ought to be heard whenever the Holy Ghost is moving. Now, natural sounds, when those patterns or waves or impulses are drawn out, it's a lower sound. When they come quicker, it's a higher pitch and higher sound. So it made me think that there's a coming and a going when the Holy Ghost witnesses through us. There is a coming and a going. There is a going up and there is a coming down. When we pray in the Holy Ghost, I get to go from the first heaven through the second heaven to the third heaven. And when he speaks in, it comes from the third heaven through the second heaven down to the first heaven. You act like you don't need this for a second there, but I'm gonna make it plain. Everybody needs the Holy Ghost. Have you ever not known what to pray for? Have you ever not knowing what to ask for? You don't know which job? Come on. I mean, there is no book of jobs. There's a book of Job. There's not a book of jobs in the Bible that tells you, you know, where you go to work. So you need some help. What the enemy will do is he will try to position himself between your voice and God's ear, or God's voice and your ear. He is the prince of the power of the air. Daniel 10. Daniel starts praying and fasting, and for 21 days he's at it. 21 days later, the angel shows up, and naturally he says, what took you so long? He says, I left the first time you prayed.
But there was a disruption. There was an interference in the second heaven. It wasn't that it was not released or sent. It could not be completely delivered. And I had to wait for reinforcements to break me free so that I could deliver the answer to you. See, when I pray in the Holy Ghost, I have the ability for my prayer to go stealth. Come on. And the enemy does not know what I'm asking for. Romans says, when I don't know how to pray as I ought, the Spirit makes intercession with groanings that he doesn't pray out of my understanding, because my understanding is limited. He prays out of my spirit. It is the deepest part of me praying to the deepest part of God. It is divinity, praying to divinity on behalf of humanity. Oh, Paul said, I speak with tongues of men and angels. If I need to talk to you, I got a tongue for that. But if I need to talk to another world, I've got a language for that. Oh, somebody say, thank you, Holy Ghost. Somebody say, thank you, Holy Ghost. I want to tell you how some of you made it. The last 3 years or so especially, it wasn't that everybody in your clique and in your club remembered to pray for you every day. You made it because you had somebody on the inside that would take up a groaning and a travailing and make intercession for you. So before I get ready to land this plane, with the sound, there must be cooperation. Are you right? Okay. He's not going to force you. It's your tongue. It's your mouth. Your vocal cords. But it's his language. Paul said, I will, emphasis on will, I will pray in the spirit. I will pray in understanding. Right? I thank my God, I speak in tongues more than you all. Okay? So what you have to do is disengage your mind, because your mind cannot fathom, it cannot comprehend what is happening on the inside of you and God praying through you. So here's what I want to show you before I close. Are you ready? Got all week to deal with this. But watch this, watch this. When there is a sound, something happens. So the sound is a sign. Tell your neighbor, the sound is a sign. It is a sign of life. Exodus 28 talks about tying a rope around the high priest, because when the high priest goes into the most holy place, if he got sin in his life, he gonna die. How you gonna know he's dead? He quit making a sound. I could get real mean right there, but I'm going to roll on. He quit making a sound. Okay, I feel it coming back on me. I might as well go ahead. Amen. Amen. Some of you ain't never made a sound. You don't want to make a sound. I'm trying to be polite here and tell you, you need to learn how to release a sound. Because the sound means you're alive. Blessed are those that know the joyful sound. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Not think so, not nod so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So at the bottom of the high priest's garment, there was a bell and a pomegranate. It was a sound and fruit, gift and fruit, gift and fruit. And as long as they could hear the sound, they knew the high priest was alive. Every time I speak in tongues, I know he's alive. And yes, I have been to Jerusalem, and yes, I have been to the empty tomb, but I didn't need to see any of that to know that he was alive. Every time I hear the Holy Ghost, I know that he made it to the right hand of the Father, and he sent the Holy Ghost back. Somebody shout yes. So sound initiates. Sound creates. It is a call to action. Jubilee started with the sound. Solomon's temple. The glory came after the sound. It didn't just show up. There has to be a sound. The Roman centurion said, I'm in authority and under authority, and I release authority by a sound. I say to one, go, and he goes.
I say to another, come, and he comes. I say to one, do this, and he does it. Right? You never know what you are pushing out and bringing in when the sound of the Holy Ghost is being made. Here's another one. Say to the mountain, move. So the sound causes action, movement. Jericho fell after the sound. Isaiah 6, the doorpost moved. Do you need anything to move? Come on. If you need something to move, then there has to be a sound released. It causes openings. Paul and Silas caused an opening. Are you ready? It didn't just cause an opening for them. It caused an opening for everybody around them. Hey, I want you to make up your mind this week that you're going to be the one that we can entrust to make sure that everybody on your row praises God. That is going to be your assignment. You're not going to let people come and nod at God. You're not going to let people come and fold their arms saying, my God, how much longer is he going to preach? But you are going to cause a sound to be heard because your praise can help set them free. That's why you can't go to no dead church. You can't, hey, we're not tombstones, we're lively stones. There ought to be a sound coming out of this house. Sound. Watch how it creates openings. David said, he said to Zadok the priest, he said to Nathan the prophet, he said, I want you to take Solomon and I want you to put him on my mule and I want you to ride him through the street and I want you to say, God save the king. And the Bible said they released a sound. And this sound was so strong until the Bible said that the earth was open. Whenever there is the sound, something is following it. Watch this. Very simple. You hear the train before you see it. You hear the airplane before you can find it. Marching bands, you're going to hear the tuba. You're going to hear the bass drum. You're going to hear the sound before you see it. When we get somebody in the room to start releasing the sound, you know that the sound is bringing something with it. The sound is bringing power. So I said, Lord, where do I stop? He said, you got to take them to David, who said, is it time for me to go fight against the Philistines? God said, no, don't fight without the sound. Because if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, how you gonna know when to fight? And I feel led of the Holy Ghost to tell some people, the reason you keep getting whipped is you are trying to fight without the sound. But you need the sound of the Holy Ghost to let you know when to go. The Bible said when that sound was released, that David bestirred himself. You know what I'm praying for this week? I'm praying for a bestirring of the Holy Ghost. I'm praying that he will so invigorate us, that he will so fill us until there is a sound released in this house. And when I hear that sound, I know that God is working on my behalf. The Bible says that four lepers walked, but yet there was a sound. And when the sound was released, it created confusion. And the enemy heard it, didn't know what was happening, and they ran off. What about Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles 20 and 20? The Bible said he sent the choir before the army. And he said, sing us out of this, boys. Hallelujah. And they sang, praise ye the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. And watch, the Bible said God set an ambushment. Every time you're praying in the Holy Ghost, God is setting ambushments. And the devil cannot decide. He cannot discern. He cannot decipher. And before you know it, he's caught in a trap. Somebody shout yes. Somebody shout yes. So I
I said, Lord, we need to release a sound. And he said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. But then I go to Revelation 1, and the Bible talks about many waters, a multitude of waters. I got a sound, you got a sound, you got a sound. Wonder what faith would sound like if everybody was filled with the Holy Ghost and we could release the sound. I want to tell you, God would be glorified and hell would be terrified. I want you to get up on your feet, throw your hands high up in the air and say, God, I want to be filled with the sound of the Holy Ghost. Hey, I want to be filled with the sound of the Holy Ghost. I say this with compassion. I'm not throwing stones, and I'm just going to leave well enough alone after this. But I feel like there's a number of people in this room, and it's been far too long since you've heard the Holy Ghost talk. You're still sitting in your seat. You're still wearing your faith t-shirt. Come on. You're still singing with the praise team. But it's been too long since you've heard the Holy Ghost witness. I believe today there's going to be a refilling of the Holy Ghost. Perhaps some of you have never received the Holy Ghost, but I believe today is your day, and I believe many others are going to be refilled with the Holy Ghost. How many of you know how crucial, how advantageous, how beneficial it is for us to have the Holy Ghost in operation in our lives? I'm going to tell you, I need me some Holy Ghost, because he has brought me through many dangers. He has sustained me and strengthened me. I got up when I didn't think I could. I took what I didn't think I could take. I stood what I didn't think I could stand. And it wasn't me. It was the Holy Ghost on the inside of me that gave me the ability to take a licking and keep on ticking. I'm telling you, God is ready to be your paracletos in the person of the Holy Ghost and come alongside to help you. I want everyone in this room that you need to be filled, or you want a refilling, I want you to get out of your seat and come stand up here right now. In fact, we may not even get to lay hands on you, but I want you to come in an attitude of expectancy and worship. Look at them. Look at them. My.